This evening's talk is going to be about fatty liver. Specifically, is your liver fit? Let's talk about fatty liver disease. My name is Monica Nelson, and I am a nurse at the Center for Liver Disease and Transplantation at Columbia University, which is part of the New York Presbyterian System. Joining us today is Tess Pottinger. Tess is a research scientist at the Institute for Genomic Medicine at Columbia University, where she performs research in the field of genetics. As in most aspects of life, diverse research teams can help to overcome biased analyses and bring more accurate findings to light. She is committed to exploring and expanding this diversity through her own career progression and helping others accomplish their goals. Also joining us this evening is Dr. Julia Wadachero, and she is a transplant hepatologist and director of our very own non-alcoholic fatty liver disease program. She loves to use science and innovation to advance patient care, but engaging people where they are is what she loves most of all. Welcome, everyone. Just to give you a little pointer on how to ask questions during the webinar, we'd like for you to put your questions in the Q&A box, and then we'll be able to answer them at the end of the presentation, okay? Because we want to hear from as many people as possible, and we want everyone to be able to participate in the webinar. Coming up next month, our next session and webinar will be on alcohol and liver disease. Let's talk about it. And we'll have Dr. Chenoy and Dr. Brown to help us with that. So what is our mission? Why are we doing this, right? And so the Black Liver Health Initiative addresses historic barriers and discovers new obstacles to health by engaging with the Black community through listening, education, awareness, and increasing access and advancement to transformational transplant care. The Black Liver Health Initiative is promoting liver health care equity in the Black community.
Good evening, everyone. It's a real delight to be with you. In order to promote healthcare equity in the Black community, we have some goals that we'll outline here, but we want to hear from you as to what our future goals should be. And hopefully there'll be a ton of time at the end to help address some of those. So for tonight, we want to explore non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. You may hear us use the term NAFLD in the context of your overall health. We want to identify some of the risk factors in the disease spectrum of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. What do our recommendations and what do the types of discussions that we have mean to you, the general public and our patients? And to understand how to advocate for your own liver health at large, and then also included in research studies. At the very end, we'll have an open Q&A and a very special guest that will be able to give you his perspective. So one of the things we love to talk about now in clinic and the hospital and gets a lot of media attention too is information and how information comes to you. Looking at this article, we have some reflection questions for you. And that is the intent of the article's marketing. Would you want to read the article? What does the image convey to you? What do you think the article will be communicating? What's the impact on you? And how will this impact your health, clicking on this article? So items for reflection, when you think about where you get your information from, what you're likely to engage, and what images and text appeal to you. Next slide. All right, so this harkens back to the first talk that you had with Dr. Lucero, and that was the review of liver basics, along with Nicole Golden. So to talk about what the liver does, it's important to learn what a healthy liver does before we learn what a diseased liver might not be able to do. So what are some of the basic functions of the liver? The liver helps break down nutrients that you consume in your food. It metabolizes many drugs. It detoxifies a lot of chemicals, one of which you'll be hearing about a lot in our next talk, and that's alcohol. It helps make proteins that help blood clot. It helps store vitamins and minerals. It also has a huge role in our immune system, and it helps make hormones, specifically that relate to metabolism, but others as well. It actually has a ton of other jobs, and we're constantly discovering more. So we're going to spend some time on this slide, and that's to walk you through what it means to have chronic liver disease. All of us on this call help take care of patients that have liver disease. And we're going to make some basic assumptions for those of you in the audience. And that's one, that you're probably most likely born with a normal liver. There will be some of you that are not, but for the vast majority of people, born with a normal liver. Now, in the timeline of events things that can affect the liver, with fatty liver disease in particular, one of the things that becomes abnormal is the liver functioning as a storage facility for fat. That's not something the liver was designed to do. Usually fat is stored underneath our skin. And so oftentimes when fat is in a place that it shouldn't be, it causes consequences. So we'll talk about how many people on this call, you think about 1 in 4 approximately, have fatty liver disease in terms of the general public. But what does that mean as the liver is affected by this fat accumulation over time? And what does that mean when it occurs in the timeline of your life? So a common question I ask a lot of patients relates to, what size were you? Approximately what size waist circumference or pants did you wear when you graduated from high school? Or did you have an abnormal sugar test when you became pregnant? Oftentimes, life events translate into different environmental influences that affect our ability to deal with them. And so whether or not it's gaining weight at the time of pregnancy, whether or not it's gaining weight at the end of a major life event like college, that sometimes can play a big role in terms of when the potential influence of fat accumulating in the liver would have occurred. In a much smaller percentage of people, that fat doesn't just cause metabolic consequences, increasing someone's risk for diabetes. It actually can lead to inflammation and scar tissue in the liver. And those are the types of people that need to see a gastroenterologist or a hepatologist like me in order to help figure out where the damage is being done and what stage it is. So if you look at the timeline that we're showing right now, when we say early fibrosis is a word that means scar tissue. And so in individuals that accumulate fat and have inflammation, they may start to accumulate scar tissue. In fatty liver disease, we think that this scar tissue takes about 5 to 7 years to advance by stage. And so in liver disease world, we consider stage 4 scarring of the liver cirrhosis. And so that's when the major architecture of the liver is really affected. The liver goes from being something sponge-like when it's normal to something brick-like when it has cirrhosis. It's those individuals that become very high risk for the liver not working and needing either a transplant or needing screening for things like liver cancer. We call that hepatocellular carcinoma. One of the main points I want to make in this talk is that that timeline can take 20, 30, 40 years to develop. So what does that mean? One, for people for whom they accelerate faster than that, we need to find them. But also, there's so much hope in this disease process. When we see it and recognize it early, there's a lot of opportunities to intervene. So what does this look like in terms of populations? So oftentimes, Monica is one of our transplant coordinators. She and I work together to help people that are standing at the edge of that cliff. So individuals that have cirrhosis or have a liver that is not just architecturally disturbed, but also functionally disturbed. It just doesn't want to work anymore. And then we have to try to rescue them as they're falling off the cliff with mechanisms like transplant. Different types of interventions to help that liver work longer until we can put a new one in them. Hopefully that is not the majority of those of you on this call today. The majority of you have hopefully no liver disease, but if any, early stage liver disease like the panel on the right. So individuals that are far more secure from the edge of the cliff, but have disease that needs to be staged and intervened upon. So when we talk about healthcare, and when you interface with people like Monica and me, it's oftentimes very, very important to think about when you're interfacing with us and what our ability to deal with certain issues are and where we're really, really limited. Now, when we talk about healthcare equity, we have to talk about inequity. So when we meet people, whether it's the time of transplant or in the healthcare community, we're meeting them at the downstream end of things, when consequences and chronic disease and injury has already occurred. But how that got there was oftentimes due to a lot of what we call upstream influences, things like structural racism, access to healthcare, insurance coverage, structural inequities in terms of policy decisions, the types of food environments, whether someone lives in a food desert or not, whether someone has access to a safe playground where they can exercise. All of those environmental factors play a huge role in how we can actually implement some interventions for those individuals that are meeting us at a much later stage in their disease. But opportunities for intervention, not just where we interface, but also upstream. Policy decisions, elected officials, regulations that we put into place regarding fast food, et cetera. So when we talk about this disease, it's important to talk about the world, because the world is influenced by all sorts of us migrating in different parts of the world. And what we see in the United States and what we export has influences across the world. Dr. Pottinger is going to spend some time talking to you about how genes have migrated, behaviors and environmental influences have migrated as well. So when we talk about non-alcoholic fatty liver disease or NAFLD, the approximate prevalence in the United States or the numbers of people that have it is about a quarter of the population. That means one out of every four people in the general public, if we're on the subway or walking down the street. Now, in certain other parts of the country, we see a higher number, a higher percentage of individuals that are influenced. And there's multiple reasons why, but we do think that ancestry has something to do with it, which we'll talk about more soon. So many of you on this call might be wondering, do I have fatty liver disease that's undiagnosed? You're going to help your healthcare provider figure that out. So some of the major comorbidities or disease associations that exist with fatty liver disease are super common. So one of them is type 2 diabetes. One of them is dyslipidemia. We included some medical words here, and hopefully we'll break those down. If there's anything that's unclear, please ask. Dyslipidemia is one of the medical words we use for cholesterol abnormalities or lipid abnormalities. Obesity, we're going to put online a little calculator. If you don't know what your BMI is or your body mass index, it's a completely imperfect standard, we acknowledge, but it's something that you should be aware of and something that you should talk to your doctor about in terms of risk factors for certain disease associations. And there's a calculator where you can put your height and weight in so that you can know your BMI. One of the things we'll say is that BMI risk for certain comorbidities and metabolic consequences vary across different ancestry groups. And so we'll talk more about that when we get to body composition. Metabolic syndrome is another one. And there's a link where you can go and figure out whether or not you have the metabolic syndrome. You should have access to your healthcare record if you're engaged with healthcare to be able to figure out some of the numbers that you'll need to plug into the assessments there. Just like in the pandemic, a lot of people had their thermometer handy and they got a pulse ox. A couple of things that we do recommend for the general public is having a weighing scale at home. If you are checking your sugars as part of a diabetes monitoring regimen or pre-diabetes monitoring regimen, knowing what your fasting blood sugar is. And then for the metabolic syndrome, something simple to have is just a tape measure so that you can calculate circumference, your waist circumference. Know that body circumferences, neck for sleep apnea, waistline for certain metabolic risk carries risk for cardiovascular disease. And so that's why having some of these measurements correlates with risk. When we talk about emerging associations, these are things that we're starting to see coexist with fatty liver disease. We see thyroid dysfunction when it's too low, hypothyroidism, obstructive sleep apnea, if any of you snore or have a partner or someone who you're around who snores, that's one of the risk factors. Hypopituitarism, so decreased function of the pituitary gland. Hypogonadism, which is decreased function of sexual glands. And then polycystic ovarian syndrome, which many of the women on this call may have, that also increases your risk for something called insulin resistance, which is how your body relates to sugar metabolism. So just to get to the numbers in text, this is a hopefully a little bit repetitive, about a quarter of the general population has, again, the umbrella term non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. That number goes way up if you have diabetes. And also if you are in the obese category or BMI over 30. NASH is the, as I described to children, the angry form of this disease that affects a smaller percentage of the population. But when you're dealing with a disease this common, it's actually quite a huge number. So we think it's between 1.5% and 6.5% of the general population. A smaller percentage, but about a quarter of people with type 2 diabetes and about a quarter to a third of people who have obesity. This is the subtype of fatty liver disease that are really important for liver doctors. It's not that the non-NASH form of fatty liver disease is not important. It means that those individuals are more likely to develop cardiovascular risks, whereas those with NASH develop both liver and cardiovascular risk. So one of the things that we love to talk about in the modern era is, how do my genes relate to my environment and my overall risk? I would say a quarter of the patients who meet me ask, will I pass this on to my children, or did I inherit this disease from my parents? And in order to be able to answer those questions, we need a lot of information. So in an individual, how their genes relate to their environment is something that we can study on an individual basis. We're currently not recommending genetic screening for our patients as a general mechanism. But as Dr. Pottinger will tell you, there have been some genes that have been found that are associated with this disease process and its progression. So in a particular individual, there may be a huge genetic risk, and that person have decreased environmental risk. For example, I have a lot of people who are not obese. They actually store normal levels of fat in their entire body, and they don't have diabetes, but they have NASH. Those people become interesting scientifically because they don't meet our classic risk factors, and they might look a little bit more like patient 3. So those are some of the patients that we're studying right now who don't necessarily meet all the clinical risk factors that we're used to assessing, but they have really, really bad disease. Is there something we can learn about their biology that can actually help us treat other people with the more common types of fatty liver disease? Now, oftentimes, I'll give you a lot of things that my patients reflect back to me in my clinic. And one of them is, I've never heard of this disease before. Why don't people know more about it? So when we talk about the prevalence of fatty liver disease, you can see on this bar graph that it's actually quite common as a disease entity, but we just don't hear enough about it. We think a lot about hepatitis C. We think a lot about breast cancer, but this disease is very, very common. And there needs to be greater awareness about it. And that's part of our mission in educating you through this webinar, but also to think about the combination of fatty liver disease and its associated risk, the other metabolic risk that it carries. So what does this mean? If you sit down with your doctor and they tell you, oh, you don't have any evidence of inflammation or scar tissue in your liver, what does that mean for your life? So it's kind of downplaying it, perhaps, to say that it's simple. But when you have fat storage in the liver, it doesn't mean that it's not important. It means that you have an increased risk for cardiovascular disease, heart attacks, strokes, potential diabetes development. When you have fat plus inflammation and or scar tissue, that's the term we call NASH, which is non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. We think that this is the more dangerous one. This is the one that we want to follow you more closely. We think that this can lead to progressive scar tissue. Again, if something's not done, if certain things are done lifestyle-wise and maybe otherwise, we can prevent that progression. So again, a lot of hope. When you have cirrhosis or end-stage scarring of your liver due to NASH, we think that you have around a 2-5% per year risk of developing liver cancer. So we try to screen you ahead of time. Liver cancer is one of those silent diseases where oftentimes patients don't feel anything. So when we know someone's at risk, we like to look periodically to make sure that they're not developing cancer. And then the word cryptogenic, crypto meaning we don't know how it got there. Quite a few patients meet us and they have cirrhosis and it's their first diagnosis of liver disease and we don't know how it got there. When we do some good detective work, we can generally find out that actually it was fatty liver that was going on for 10, 20, 30 years, but wasn't recognized. Again, it's oftentimes quite silent and asymptomatic, or it doesn't have clear associated symptoms that get recognized. So some key elements to make the diagnosis for all the people that are wondering, do I have this, do I not? So when you go and see your healthcare provider, it's great to have an armamentarium of information because it's you. And what you will talk about are all the associated risk factors. So when we talk about alcohol consumption, which you'll get to on the next webinar, we talk about beer, wine, hard liquor, drinks per day, drinks per week, and associated behaviors with alcohol consumption. So being really open and honest with your healthcare provider about those habits is super important. When we say competing etiologies, that's a laundry list of other things that we should exclude before we say that someone has fatty liver disease. We have to have a picture, something that tells us that there is fat in the liver, apart from a biopsy, that hints at this disease process. It's not something that we detect with a simple blood test yet. And then liver enzymes, your AST and ALT, those of you that have your labs pulled up, those are liver enzymes, and they may or may not be elevated with this disease process. That's also something where we need to increase our recognition, both with healthcare providers, but also with patients. And in 2021, the only way that we still diagnose NASH is with a biopsy. And so that's something that your doctor may or may not talk about. So then you can ask the question, but do I have to have a liver biopsy? And for the vast majority of individuals, next slide, the answer is no. There has been an emergence of what we call non-invasive tests. Can you go to the next slide, Monica? Yeah. So there's a whole bunch of information that exists in your healthcare record and in your life and in your story that you will be helping your doctor or your healthcare provider put together. And in order to decide on whether or not you need a liver biopsy, there are some things that we're going to pull from your chart, things like your BMI, your AST, and different types of things. And we can put them into an online calculator. One of many is shown there. And these are things that you can do when you have access to your own records as well, given a little bit of guidance. Okay. We also have lots of picture taking tools, imaging tools that help us assess where on that timeline are you. Do you have fat in your liver without any scar? Do you have halfway to cirrhosis level scar? Or do you have evidence of what looks like cirrhosis? There's a whole bunch of technologies in this area that are helping us make more practical decisions. We can't biopsy a quarter of the population. So make more practical decisions about which patients to biopsy, which patients can we monitor in what vein. And the question always comes up, what can I do? There's sometimes a debate about whether or not we should screen for this disease. And many people say, oh, you can't do anything. There's no treatment for it. But that's not really true. There's a lot we can do. And a provider who sits down with you and takes a good physical movement, physical activity, or exercise history can help you make some wise decisions about exercise, implementing exercise in your life, which has a clear impact on your liver, even if the numbers don't change on your weighing scale. As you can see, it reduces fat within the liver. And then weight loss. Weight loss is way more complex than calories in and calories out, but even a modest amount of weight loss can lead to even reversal of liver disease. So when we sit down with our patients, let's say someone on this call is 260 pounds and they say, you know, how much weight do I have to lose? Do I have to get to 150 pounds? The answer is one, there's not a specific number that we can dial in to tell you exactly this is going to change every single laboratory parameter or your risk, but we can make some general recommendations that again, apply to the general public, but may not be specific for you. So I can't say it enough. These are all general recommendations that I want you to, that we want you to take to your healthcare provider in discussion. But if you were 260 pounds, 10% of that weight is 26 pounds. And so you'll start to see some of the metabolic effects at 3 to 5% weight loss. So that's around 13 pounds. Most of the time when our patients hear what our recommendations are for weight loss, it's much less numerically than they anticipated. So oftentimes, in addition to lifestyle maneuvers, in order to implement it in a busy working individual's life, how do I implement resistance training? How do I implement 15 minutes of aerobic or cardiovascular activity? These are things that we can get creative about, but also our limitations when it comes to structural healthcare, to structural racism in the healthcare model. So when we come to opportunities to try to intervene, we try to focus those on what your actual environment looks like, what you have access to, and what you like to do. So these are all opportunities to engage your healthcare provider. So transitioning from environmental influences to how we study some of the biology and the disease, and moving between the social construct, which is race, and the more biological construct, which is ancestry, we want to emphasize one big point, and that there is no genetic basis for race. We're going to talk a lot about genes right now as I hand off to Dr. Pottinger, but we want to be clear about that. The aspects that we see when we talk about different racial categories, that's a social construct that's been created and underscores some of the upstream and even downstream effects that we see. So next I'm going to hand off to my good friend, Dr. Tess Pottinger, to carry us forward when it comes to the talk about fatty liver disease and genes.
Thank you, Dr. Water-Cheryl, for that great introduction and great education of NAFLDs. So as Dr. Water-Cheryl has already mentioned, there is no genetic basis for race. So how do we as scientists study race and genetics? We do so by studying the movement of population and changes in DNA, which are the basic building blocks of all living things. Next slide, please. So approximately 60,000 years ago, modern humans left Africa, moved through the world, settled, and populated. And when they did this, they acquired genetic changes, many of which were non-disease causing. So we see different changes that are associated with differences in eye color, hair texture, and skin color. However, there are some changes that are disease causing, and some of which are actually as a result of environmental pressures. One such disease is sickle cell anemia, which arose in population that had large amounts of malaria. So how do we continue to study these different genetic changes and make these findings with disease? Next slide, please. We do so by studying big data. Now, big data is just a fancy word for saying that we collect lots of information. And for our purposes, this information includes clinical information, which Dr. Water-Cheryl has already talked about, and of course, genetic information. So I'm sure many of you have probably seen the commercials these genetic testing kits. And probably some of you probably sent in your own data. And so you've seen commercials for maybe 23andMe, Ancestry DNA, and also My Heritage DNA. There are also companies that are targeted at individuals of African ancestry. So we have African Ancestry and AfroRoots DNA. Now, for those of you who have never heard of these testing kits, they send you a kit, you send back a saliva sample, and they give you a ton of information on your genetics. So a lot of them are focused on ancestry information. So what percentage of your DNA is actually from sub-Saharan Africa, South Africa, Europe, Asia. Some of them also send you information about your caffeine metabolism. So do you only need one cup, or do you need those extra three cups to get you through the day? And of course, for our purposes, we're also interested in clinical information that you can get back from these testing kits. So how do we utilize this information in healthcare? Next slide. So imagine two patients going through the healthcare system with liver disease. Both have different ancestry makeups, and these ancestry groups might have different prevalence of disease. Next slide. And so when we scan their genetic information, next, we see that, next also, we see that they have different genetic changes that might be associated or linked to their liver disease. Now, why do we care about ancestry in this instance? Unfortunately, a lot of the information that we have in genetics are based on individuals of European ancestry or white individuals. Therefore, when we find a genetic change in someone who's non-European or not white, it is sometimes difficult to assess or understand if this change is actually disease-causing. And you can imagine this has implications on diagnostics and how patients are treated and how quickly we can get to a final answer for this patient. So how are we trying to fix that now? Next slide. We are trying to increase the diversity in a lot of our clinical studies and our biomedical studies. Now, we're not only collecting the genetic information, but as Dr. Water-Cherrill already mentioned, we're also collecting environmental and social information just to understand what percentage of the clinical outcome is actually caused by your genetics and how much is caused by social or environmental factors. Now, Dr. Water-Cherrill has already mentioned access to care. Now, access to care is not based in genetics, but based on, unfortunately, race and institutional racism, which has been used to marginalize many groups. So in adding diversity to some studies, one such study is the Dallas Heart Study, next slide, we're able to find something very interesting. In individuals who are African-American, 1 in 50 actually have a genetic change that's linked to low cholesterol, which was a very interesting finding, very cool. And this information is currently being used by drug companies and pharmaceutical companies to develop better treatments and better targets for individuals with high cholesterol. So you see, adding diversity increases our impact on our community and our friends and families with high cholesterol. Next slide. So we're continuing to try to find genetic changes that have large impacts where we can make better drugs and better treatments for disease. And so what hints do we have about NAFLD based on genotype? So just to orient you to this slide, countries in red have higher prevalences or higher amounts of NAFLD, and countries in yellow have lower percentages. So it's a difference between above 30% and 10%. And the countries in orange are somewhere in between 10 and 30%. Now, in the same Dallas Heart Study, we found that a genetic change is this one gene called PNPLA3 was linked to higher proportions of NAFLD. So when we look at these pie charts here and we look at the areas in light blue, those are the percentages of individuals from those countries that have the bad genetic change that's linked to higher amounts of NAFLD. When we look at the United States and we look at Hispanic Americans, we see that they have a larger percentage of this genetic change that's linked to higher NAFLD, unfortunately, while individuals who are African American have lower percentages. Next slide. So in the beginning of trying to increase diversity in a lot of these studies, we relied heavily on self-reported race and ethnicity. However, we quickly realized when we looked at the genetic ancestry and the self-report that oftentimes those things don't overlap. And this is even more pronounced in areas with large immigrant populations because different countries have their own unique history of race, racism, and self-identification. So if we look at this slide, I'm just gonna bring up one example here where we see a study that was done in individuals that are self-reported as Asian. Now, as you know, Asia is quite large. So are they talking about individuals from India, individuals from China, or individuals from South Korea? And having this information can have implications as to what information you can find when you conduct a genetic analysis. Now, outside of research, we're seeing that self-identification in itself is changing. And one example that I can give is amongst individuals of African descent, that we're moving a little bit away from the term African-American to people of the African diaspora, which is how I personally identify, as I am of the African diaspora, but also culturally Afro-Caribbean. Now, I keep on talking about increasing diversity in the actual studies themselves, but in order to continue to increase trust amongst the community, we need to also increase diversity amongst the people who are handling this data and doing this research, so people feel like they are invested and their researchers are invested in what they find from these studies. So anything I find that in a population that looks like me will not only impact me, but also my own family and my own community. And so with that, I hand it back over to Dr. Water Cheryl to introduce our next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pottinger. It is a pure delight to be able to introduce you to one of our patients who has volunteered to talk to us tonight to share his experience with you. So if you don't mind turning on your camera, Ferdinand, so that everyone can see your face. Welcome. And I'm going to turn the floor almost completely over to you. Please, if you are putting questions in the Q&A and you have specific patient perspective questions, we'd love to prioritize those. But until then, Ferdinand, please tell us about yourself.
Good evening, Doc. Thanks for having me, giving me an opportunity to talk. Again, my name is Ferdinand Torres. I'm 55 years old, pretty much grew up in Brooklyn. My ancestry is varied, just like most people from New York, I guess. I have a significant amount of African genes in me. My makeup, I often get asked how I identify. I think it's better what I represent, and I represent a lot of different cultures and communities based on my gene pool. I was diagnosed with my liver problems, my NASH, NAFLD, if you will. I guess after getting a couple of blood tests for blood donations, somebody just said, hey, you should get checked. You have high liver enzymes. Didn't pay much mind, but as I got older, I needed elective surgery. I said, you know what? Let me go get that checked out. I did, and my path led me to you. Living with it's a little difficult. I never have been a heavy alcohol user. I know it's pretty much genetic based on my family history. It's just hard dealing with it, you know. Try to maintain a healthy weight, get there and try to stay there, watch my diet. Basically follow doctor's advice, you know. That's what I try to do.
What's been the most helpful advice you've been given, Ferdinand, either from friends, family, colleagues, healthcare providers, anyone?
It's twofold, I guess. Get to and maintain a healthy weight. And like you said, it's not a big number that you told me. And the other thing is basically watch my diet, which those are the two best things I've heard. You know, watch what I consume, cut down on some sugars, red meats, other stuff that also impacts my cardiovascular health. Watch my cholesterols. You know, those are probably the two greatest pieces of advice I ever got.
You know, I don't know if I've used this term with you, Ferdinand, but I call it the knowing doing gap. The vast majority of people know what they should be doing, but doing things are hard, as we know from the pandemic, right? So has there been anything particularly unhelpful that someone has said or done that made the doing hard?
Kind of, yeah. I don't want to put any specific meal plan down, but somebody said, hey, you should get on the keto diet. And I'm like, oh, wait, I can't cut down on all my carbohydrates. And somebody I know said, that's not good for your cardiovascular. So I think that was the worst thing, you know, just advice that's non-medical. I mean, if you're not sure, I'll bug you for answers. I'll ask my doctor. So I think that's what everybody should do. I mean, that's the best advice you can give, I guess.
Okay. You kind of got to my last question, which is what you might, if you're sitting across from someone on the subway and they're worried about their liver, you know, what to do next, they don't have necessarily a healthcare provider or someone that they've historically trusted. what might you advise them on how to get to someone that they trust?
That's tough. I mean, like the ad that you showed earlier today, that Newsweek ad, I mean, that person in the picture didn't represent me. So if I saw that ad, I might not read the article. So I think the best thing is, I mean, there's got to be somebody they interact with. I mean, it might be even be a pharmacist. Hey, I've been thinking about my liver. Can you recommend somebody in a neighborhood? Anywhere I think you touch the healthcare profession, the medical profession, even the pharmacy, ask a question, get a direction. I think that's the start. Asking the question, I think, is the most important thing. Like, is my liver healthy? I think that's the one thing you can do. Once you start asking questions, you'll get on that path.
Yeah. So you're suggesting that people need to want to know, right?
Absolutely. You have to want to know. You don't want it to sneak up on you. Yeah. I mean, that's the last thing. Caught early, I mean, there's nothing better. I mean, like you said, 30, 40 years to fully develop into something. That means you got 30, 40 years to work on it, right? To get better.
Yeah. I want to emphasize that's not necessarily true for everybody.
Right.
So we do need to, that's one of the things that Tess and I work on, is trying to figure out which genes might actually help people avoid, you know, who's at risk, kind of like PCSK9, who has every single risk factor but manages to avoid any scar tissue or even fat accumulation. We call those protected. And then some individuals who move through those stages at a rapid clip, and what might be contributing to that. So thanks for your comments there. One of the questions that came from the audience was, how can family best support loved ones with NAFLD and NASH? I'll give some impressions from my years of taking care of people, but Ferdinand, what's been most helpful from a support perspective for you?
Little hints, you know, good meal prep, suggestions on diet, maybe a suggestion of, hey, let's go for a nice long walk instead of let's sit down and watch TV. I mean, any way my family can interact with me and the things that I need to make me healthy, I mean, that's what I find the most helpful, I think. And it helps. It does.
Okay. I would also say a lot of my patients, not Ferdinand, but a lot of my patients come to me and they're quite sad and depressed because they have been shamed for being an alcoholic their entire life, and they've never had alcohol influence their life, either not a single drop or very minimal. And someone knows that they have liver diseases, judges and shames them. So that's just not helpful to that person, to any of us, in order to try to get them better. So avoiding certain types of behaviors, avoiding stigmatizing conversations or judgments, that's something we all have to work on all the time. That is something to avoid. And then from a support perspective, oftentimes I don't let family members be the warden when it comes to diet and exercise, because those relationships are complex. And sometimes it's hard to receive certain types of advice with the complexities of mother, father, sister, brother, son, daughter, trying to be coaching, but maybe not coming off as your coach. So outsourcing a little bit of that is sometimes the way to help support someone, is actually to not say what you're thinking, or to ask, you know, what would be helpful at this time, just to bring it up directly. One of the other questions that came in from the audience are there any dietary restrictions people with NAFLD should be aware of and practicing? I'll tell you, we try to bust a lot of myths or correct a lot of things that it's hard to understand simply by Googling. So one of the things I want to advise you to do is talk about what sources of information or where you go for information with your healthcare provider, so they can help distill that out. Some things are uniformly unhelpful and some things can be really, really helpful. The two links that we gave are NIH and NHLBI, one of the heart lung associations, and then the American Heart Association. Those are both good places to wander around on the web if you're worried. Not worried, but if you're concerned that you might have the disease. Simple things. So meeting with a dietitian, I tell my patients, if you have a smartphone or a camera, take a picture of everything you eat for 3 days. Don't change anything, and bring that to your dietitian consult. Simply speaking, a lot of times people think, I have fatty liver disease, I need to avoid fat altogether. And they think that you take in fat in your mouth and it becomes fat in your liver. It doesn't work that way. Fatty liver disease actually has a lot to do with carbohydrate metabolism. So one of the things that we ask you to do, simple things, is switch everything white to brown, because it has a lot to do with sugar metabolism and carbohydrate metabolism. What does that mean? White rice, white pasta, white tortillas, white roti, switch to something that's a little bit more integral, something that's the wheat-based, et cetera. So if, and this does, this crosses culture lines, et cetera. I know that that may be difficult at first, so we can work that into simple recommendations, but those are some very quick things that we can say, apart from you sitting down with someone who knows your, what you're putting in your body already, and can make a fine-tuned suggestion based on what your lifestyle demands and what you have time for in terms of food preparation.
I'd like to just jump in if I can and ask a question to the panelists. So there was a question that came in to the panelists. Are there any studies being developed to identify NASH in a wider population with the increase of obesity in the world? The second part of that question is, what about if your weight is numerically higher than your BMI, but you have a muscular build?
Okay, I will tackle the first one first, and that studies. The final answer is yes, because this disease is so common, we need to identify it earlier. One of the things that can happen is it gets lumped into the other disease categories. And so there's less, you know, it takes money to study something. And so to identify people early without the advanced, more expensive picture-taking tools that we have, sometimes that takes areas of investment. And so quick point of care, think about like a saliva test for the coronavirus, things that are available at the point of an individual's life, home, et cetera, would be an ideal thing. If I could, you know, wish a magical probe to go on my smartphone to be able to help me see liver fat inside the liver, instead of using my fancy technology we have in the clinic, that would be ideal. So if there's anyone in development, develop that tool. But the answer is yes, there are many, many studies. The primary focus right now, you know, we try to be pragmatic in healthcare because resources are limited. We want to try and scoop up people at the closer to the edge of the cliff. So we want to find people that have a lot of scar tissue and try to rescue them so that they don't develop cancer, so they don't have a need for transplant. And it's not that we're ignoring everybody, but given our resource pool that we have, we want to try and focus some of those efforts on people with more scar tissue. Because again, we think about things in terms of life and death. And then when it comes to the BMI body composition question, we know it's not perfect. NFL players have a very, very high BMI. Fortunately, most of the population is not an NFL player, but it's not a perfect measure for you. So this is where you need to get more into the precise measurements for you, your body composition, your fat mass, your muscle mass, and how you metabolize. And that's a discussion for you to have with your provider.
Thank you, Dr. Wadacheryl. The other question that came in the chat is, are there forums or support groups for individuals living with NASH?
There are several. Monica, you're part of one with me. The Global Liver Institute is an advocacy group that works a lot in the policy terrain. We have tons of NASH education. The NASH Education Program is another resource that we can point you to. I think they're up to 12 or 18 languages there's materials in. And then several of the patients have organized their own social media groups to help advise. Just like Ferdinand said, ask a trusted friend or colleague, because it's not just about how smart someone is, it's how they relate to you. Do you trust them? And so some of that gets conveyed in means that I wouldn't even know of. So Ferdinand might be able to answer that question.
No, I agree. Social media is great. I'm doing your own little research. I mean, watch what you read on the internet, obviously, but talk to people and definitely talk to your doctor. I love Columbia Presbyterian. I'll ask them anything.
Oh, there's another question in the chat about if liver flush would be helpful. Doing a liver flush.
One of the things I love to do in our transplant workshop is find out what celebrity is recommending. So I don't know who's recommending the liver flush. And I don't even know if it's a brand, but oftentimes those cleanses, detoxes, et cetera, they're kind of hints And so I want to be curious with you as to why you want to use it, because that sometimes tells me that you're a little bit concerned about your liver, and maybe you do or you don't have a liver disease. So it's, again, something that we want to find out what your motivation is in wanting to take it. Look at the ingredients. Most of those compounds are not regulated at all, and they're highly contaminated with things that are not supposed to be there. So there are opportunities. One of the best liver flushes is actually fasting. And so one of the things that your liver does is store glycogen. It's a type of fuel for you in case you're ever starving. And so some of the rationale behind intermittent fasting and things like that is intentionally depleting your liver of one of those stores. It's a much longer conversation than we'll go to now. In general, I would say avoid those types of cleanses, detoxes, et cetera, definitely until you talk to your provider. And then also reflect on what about it is attracting you to it. Is it because you binged the weekend before and you want to try to do something healthy? Or is it because you're scared of pharmaceutical products and that's something you need to bring up with your provider?
Keeping along the lines of what we can put in our body, we have a question that says, I changed all foods to wheat, but then I was told I have too much potassium in my blood and to change the foods back to white. What are your thoughts, your advice?
Oh, this is starting to get into the very specific domain. So we would need to sit down with you and go through a lot of your specific nutritional influences that are probably your unrelated to just the carbohydrates. And then also look at your kidney function and other things that might be influencing some of those electrolytes that you're talking about, like potassium. So I'm not trying to avoid your question, but this is exactly why things that we say in a public forum may not apply to you specifically. Oftentimes patients hear things on the news. I am not your doctor, apart from Ferdinand. I am not your doctor. I can't speak to you specifically, but that's a really good question for you to sit down with your healthcare provider about.
The other question on food is addressing the keto diet on the liver, its impact.
So I wish I had a chart of all the different diets. So most of, I would say the vast majority of my patients can lose weight. And they can use a host of different types of diets. As yet, we haven't compared all of the different diets head to head over a long period of time, looking at all things, body composition, metabolism, risk factors for all sorts of diseases. What I always think about when it comes to specific diets are, what are the risks? With the keto diet, you're inducing ketosis, which is a form of starvation, and it almost always will lead to weight loss, a lot of water loss too. But I'm always worried about long-term effects. Again, I'm not worried that the individual in front of me is going to do short-term. Oftentimes we never pick up on any short-term effects, but when that diet is continued over a long period of time, there are a lot of unknowns, and that may not be wise for that individual, especially when it's very high in things like saturated fat or in red meats or solid fats at room temperature. And so when you have someone who already has high cardiovascular risk, and then you're increasing their amount of fats in their diet, that's a long-term heart disease risk that, again, that individual may not be able to sustain. One of the things that this keeps bringing up is that patients appropriately, the public is very, very interested in nutritional recommendations, but honestly, we don't have a ton of longitudinally well-done studies. And so whether it's the precision nutrition endeavor that the NIH is putting on or many other different types of studies, this is an area that is that we need a lot of study in, because it relates to what you put in your body on a day-to-day basis and some of the effects of that, bad and good.
Thank you. Another question from the chat is talking about knowledge transfer to the next generation. There's limited community outreach and information out there about fatty liver. What resources are available to organically share in a family discussion?
What a great question. Tess, you can probably use this as an opportunity too. One of the things that we are trying to do in the genetics community is have people talk about genes and not just health-related risks, but around Thanksgiving, hopefully if we can get together again, talking about your family history. That's super important. One of the things that we hear a lot in clinic is, I don't know what diseases my parents had or what they died of. So getting that information out to your relatives is a big component of your health history. And then resources that I named already, the National Education Program, some of the patient advocacy groups, and we'd be happy to supply this to you as well. These are patient made, so you don't get the medicalese that often comes out of healthcare providers' mouths, patient facing types of documents that help you distribute this information in a friendly way that relates to, you know, our family drinks a lot of soda. And so this is what helped me eliminate soda from my diet, or my kids don't have a safe playground that they can go to. These are the resources. The closer you get to the community, your neighborhood, and what's been effective, that's where you can share recipes, you can share stories, you can share strategies.
Thank you. A question in the chat says, I've been diagnosed with NAFLD, but my primary care doctor said just to lose weight. He didn't seem that concerned. Should I see a specialist to provide more guidance on how to manage the condition?
It sounds like you want more. So the first advice I would give you is tell your provider that. Say, if you feel comfortable asking and say, I would like to know a little bit more about this disease and if I'm at risk for certain other things. And you can pull up your patient education information and say, this is what I learned about the disease. You will know you're a smart individual, whether or not that person will invest the time, eye contact, effort in explaining that to you. And if you're not satisfied with your response, by all means, seek specialty care. The part of it is the discussion and the reassurance. It's not just the stage of disease. It's that you feel satisfied with that encounter. And that's a real area that we have to work on in healthcare. If you are not satisfied with that discussion, or you very appropriately have access to your labs and you are putting in some online calculators and you find that you are in a category that we call advanced fibrosis, that means more scar tissue, bring that to your doctor. Patients that do that stuff online and force the conversation are hugely important to the advancement of health. That's where you can be your own advocate and say, my score is pretty high. Is this something I should be worried about? Again, based on the response that you get, you'll know everything you need to know about how that conversation lands with you and whether or not you want to seek additional care. Never hurts to get second opinions.
Thank you. I think we have time for the last two questions in the chat. And so this one is back to food. And so I'm from the Caribbean with family history of liver disease. We use bush medicine, bitter bush or Chinese bitter melon as examples. Are you aware of any adverse effects of bitter melon? And then the second one is the difference between keto and starvation.
So let me start with the first question first. Some of these bitter melon type nutrient-seeking endeavors are actually to deal with glucose metabolism. They exist in many of the tropical countries where people have a very similar risk of diabetes. South Asians, et cetera, have a very similar, and also because of the vestiges of indentured servitude, slavery, and different exports of people groups across the world. So from when it comes to bitter melon and the suggestions that you're making, a lot of that has to do, as far as I'm aware, with glucose metabolism. And the whether or not it's been studied on its effects on sugar metabolism in a lab or in humans, I do not have that knowledge. I don't think so. However, a lot of what you'll see in folk medicine or natural medicine has its origin in something that had been observed. Where we need to advance the field is studying these types of interventions. And so not dismissing them just because they came from somewhere else, but also looking at what's the active compound in this and is it doing something good? You know, whether it's hibiscus tea, that's also very common in different parts of the world, whether it's star anise, there's all these types of things that are antihypertensives or cholesterol lowering or sugar lowering. There is a basis of that in science, but how it relates to you is probably that you would use it as an adjunct with something that's been scientifically proven to help lower your blood sugar if you needed something like that. And then Monica, remind me the second question.
Yeah, it was fasting versus starvation to heal the liver.
Right. So this is something I don't want anyone to walk off of this Zoom webinar and starve for the next 24 hours and say that it was part of fatty liver disease treatment. So we're not at all advocating for starvation. I was drawing an analogy. So oftentimes when the body enters a state of ketosis, it's being starved. And so ketone bodies are something that your body produces that reflect how your muscles and your body tissues are receiving oxygen and how they're receiving nutrients. And so when we induce certain artificial states, it can oftentimes have a temporary beneficial effect, but a long-term harmful effect. And so that's what I was trying to refer to when I was talking about it. Starvation in and of itself has multiple phases. And that's not something that we would advocate for, especially in high-risk groups. So that is something, if you are thinking about starting on an intermittent fasting program, or as part of a religious pilgrimage or part of a religious practice, definitely bring it up with your physician, your healthcare provider. They can talk about, you know, what might be safe for you, or if you're pregnant or in one of these high risk groups and it's not recommended or not considered safe for you.
Thank you, Dr. Wadacharo, and thank you, Dr. Pottinger. There is just a request from Iowa that says they're watching the presentation from Iowa and would like a presentation in the future on sickle cell disease and liver disease and treatment. And that's from Jeremy. We'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. And this is the way that you can connect with us at nyp.org/BLHI. This is the website. And this is how you can find us. These are our lists of locations. There's one in Washington Heights and one on the East Side. And these are our phone numbers. Thank you everyone for joining.